Now back to the show. This is The Law Show on CL 650.
Our producer, Dwayne Bishop, found a song called Big Crash because the guys who worked the Big Crash, Joe Murphy and Bill Dick from Murphy Batista in Vancouver, are in the studio. Sterling Fox with you on The Law Show this early January Sunday morning. Just before we get into the whole anatomy of an ICBC injury claim, I was asking both of you earlier about questions for individuals to ask of lawyers. And we've learned, courtesy mostly of you, that they're in this end of the law, there are some individuals and law firms who work both for ICBC and for individual defendants, or plaintiffs, rather. And is there an obligation, Joe, when you are shopping for a lawyer and you encounter one of these individuals, does that lawyer have to tell you that I know you want me to take your case as a plaintiff in a personal injury, but I do work for ICBC too? Do they have to tell me that?
I don't believe they do, which makes it important for the person shopping for the lawyer to ask the question, does your firm do ICBC defense work?
Okay.
So that's the question that should be asked. If the lawyer says yes, the client's got to realize that they're ability to be tough with ICBC, to play hardball, which is necessary sometimes,
right,
is affected, because any firm that does ICBC defense work signs a contract with ICBC that has a provision in it which says, and by the way, if we act against you on behalf of an injured person, we will be quite polite.
Oh, is that right?
I'm paraphrasing.
Obviously, right.
But the reality is sometimes you have to be tough. You have to play hardball.
Right.
And with a firm that does both plaintiff and defense work, their ability to do that is compromised.
I was just going to say, Bill, it'd be tough if you were the lawyer in that situation to be yelling at some guy at ICBC one day on behalf of your client and the next day talking to the same individual on a case you're working on together.
Yeah, you have to be prepared, like Joe said, to play hardball when it's necessary and have nothing stand in the way of doing that. I think Joe's right. I think it does compromise you.
I think we're too shy. I think we're a little alienated when it comes to the law. I mean, we watch too many law shows on TV. I know I'm guilty as charged. But when it comes to actual encounters with the law, most individuals feel almost instantly alienated. It's stepping into a new world with different language, different rules, costumes for crying out loud in court, and the whole bit. It's just really, really a different world. So when we're shopping for a lawyer, and Joe, there are circumstances of dire need involved here and serious injury and people's lives put it at high risk, why don't we play hardball more when we're shopping for a lawyer in order to get that right person first time?
Well, Sterling, if we're talking about a bad injury and immediately after, this whole family's in crisis. Let's say they've got a 19-year-old son who's on the spine unit at VGH with a quadriplegia, paraplegia, someone in a coma following an accident with a bad brain injury.
Right.
This family is in crisis and they're vulnerable and they just don't have the knowledge to know what questions to ask. So they, in that situation, often rely on someone to give them advice to say, this is a good lawyer. It's often a good idea to speak to two or three firms.
Right.
But the starting point is finding out firms that do this kind of work, that do it well, which involves going to trial sometimes.
Yes.
And in my mind, that doesn't do ICBC defense work as well.
Okay. And so, again, that's not a rude question, Bill. Again, I'm trying to attack our politeness factor, because in many ways for Canadians, it hangs us up. It inhibits us from asking smart or sharp pointed questions. And for example, to ask, do you work for the other guys every now and then? That's a fair question to ask. It's not rude or impolite at all, is it?
No, and sometimes it's not even really a politeness issue as much as a knowledge issue. They just don't know the questions to ask because they've never been involved. As Joe says, they're in shock. Their whole family has been disrupted.
Well, that's it.
They need help, and they're looking for it, and they're looking for it quite quickly. And so it may just be that they don't know the questions to ask, but certainly there's a lot of questions that people should be asking when they're shopping for lawyers.
Okay.
And you're right. I mean, we're very polite people as Canadians. And I think a lot of people...
Frightfully.
I think a lot of people think all lawyers are equal. And it's just like any professional. That's just not the case.
Right. And by the way, if any more questions, good questions for us to ask a potential lawyer come to you while we're talking, just include them in a conversation.
Well, there's one, Sterling. I think a client should say, if I hire the firm, who is going to be doing my file?
That's right.
Because it's often the case where the interviews with a senior lawyer, the firm is hired, and suddenly an unknown junior lawyer pops up.
Right.
On the file, and there are very bright, capable junior lawyers, but the person should know that when they're hiring the firm.
Now, when I suppose I'm in a person in crisis with a serious injury suddenly in my life, and I approach Murphy Batista in that initial free consultation moment, are you going to be able to, do you know, based on that initial conversation where you assess my case and the firm's likelihood of accepting it, do you also make a determination at that time, Joe, you're the senior guy here, that I'm not going to handle this myself, I'm probably going to pass it along to so-and-so, and would you make that disclosure in that initial meeting?
Well, if that was my plan, Sterling, that I would have that other lawyer there for the meeting.
Oh, great. Okay.
So that these people not only understood who was going to be running their file, but had met that person.
Right from day one.
Yes.
Okay, so no surprises. That's a big part of it, too, isn't it,
Bill? It's unfair to do it otherwise.
Okay. Let's get started on this, because they brought some homework here, for goodness sake, and it's the first show of January of 2016, so we better follow the rules here and get through the anatomy of an ICBC injury claim. And this is a process that happens, of course, every day in British Columbia to one degree or another in terms of injury. Your firm, Joe Murphy, typically dealing with people of the more serious the injured nature, but let's start us off here and get us going on this.
Well, Sterling, when a new client walks in the door, one of the questions I ask is, have you had an injury claim with ICBC before? I want to know if they understand how the system works. Most people haven't. My record is one client who was injured in 8 accidents.
Oh, my.
Every time she recovered, she got back into her car and someone ran into her again, to the point where she became very fearful to get back in her car, but she had 8 accidents.
Oh, my.
So the average person coming in said, no, I've never had an accident.
Right.
I don't know how the system works. And in that first meeting, I try and give them an overview of just how the system works, what our role is, what's going to happen to them, and in a few minutes can give them that overview. But the reality is every case is unique. The process every case goes through is unique, but there are certain fundamentals. The fundamentals is that ICBC, as soon as they know about the claim, is going to begin an investigation. And with a serious injury, they're going to potentially hire an engineer to go up and look at the scene, hire an engineer to examine the vehicle, examine the seat belts.
Right.
ICBC automatically gets a copy of the police report, so they begin with an understanding of who the witnesses are, and they want to get out and interview the witnesses. So it's important for people to understand that ICBC, that's on the other side of this claim, from day one, from the moment the claim is reported to ICBC, usually on the phone,
sure,
begins the process of investigating the claim with the purpose, like any insurance company, to minimize their exposure, their payment on the file.
Right.
And that's a really good point, because a lot of people don't know that they should potentially hire a firm to represent them to even the playing field.
I was just going to say, Joe's talking about from day one, and ICBC is on it. How quickly, Bill, should a family or an injured party's representatives seek legal counsel and get on it?
Well, let me give you a really good example. It's funny, because I was just telling Joe about that earlier today, of a claim where we got involved a little bit late, but fairly early, but you know, about a month into it. And one of the issues sometimes is the speed of a vehicle. And with newer vehicles, you can actually download that information from the black box.
Okay.
Engineers can get that information, and right before the accident, if the airbags go off, you can actually know exactly how fast the car is going.
Right.
So when we got on it, one of the questions that I asked a family member, because their mother was a quadriplegic, was how fast was the car going? And the person driving it said, you know, relatively modestly, relatively slowly. What kind of car was it? It was a newer car. So I got on the phone with an engineer who went to go to where the yard was, where the car was being kept, got there, it was in Merritt, and found out that the car had been shipped out to be scrapped. So that critical piece of information was potentially lost
in the course of just a month.
And fortunately, this engineer was great, found out where that car had been shipped to Abbotsford to get scrapped, went there, got that information, downloaded it, and it turned out to be absolutely critical because the driver was speeding at an excessive rate, much more than he said he was driving. So it turned out to be absolutely critical.
I see. So
timing.
The police report indicated one speed.
Well, no, the police report didn't know. The driver said he was going slower.
I see. The facts of the matter, as determined by the engineer, proved otherwise.
Had we been on that file a week or two later, wouldn't have had that information.
Gone.
It would have been gone. So ICBC, with their significant resources, can right off the bat get engineers, independent adjusters to go out there and get critical information, where if you don't get to your lawyer quickly, that's lost to you.
Sterling, clients will often say to me, when is the best time to hire a lawyer? And the answer is the sooner the better. Yeah. Our fee is the same whether you hire us on the day after the accident or 6 months later. I was hired on one case 6 years after an accident. And it became very, very difficult. My client was a young fellow with a horrible brain injury. He couldn't speak. And I think even if he could, he wouldn't remember the accident. So it really made the investigation of the accident so much more difficult.
With no cooperation from the victim, yeah.
He couldn't even speak.
Right.
But in that case, I was fortunate because when I questioned the defendant driver at what's called an examination for discovery, he said certain things that really made our case. But, you know, the sooner the better. That's the answer. When, the sooner the better.
Especially, Bill, given the fact that, as Joe just pointed out, effective the moment they're notified of the claim, ICBC is on the file. They've got people. They have a process. The wheels begin to turn the moment they are made aware of this, of the facts of this case. Right. So they're already moving. So the faster the injured party can be represented, the more advantageous it is for that individual.
That's true on the investigation and liability side. And it's also true, I think, because lawyers can help their injured clients through that initial phase of getting rehabilitation benefits and help steer them through that bureaucratic process.
Joe, just before we go to break, suppose you're in an accident scenario, you're involved in a crash-up of some kind, but you're not disabled. You can walk away from it. Your bell may have been rung, but you walk away. But you're not right, and you know it. Something's amiss. And as days go by, your head aches, and you know that something's wrong. As a result of that accident, I'm just not right. I should probably speak to a lawyer. Again, the sooner the better, right?
Yes, but the reality is, you're talking about cases with what's called a concussion or a mild traumatic brain injury.
Yes.
These people go off into a dark room. They don't have much contact with others, thinking, I just got to hunker down and I'm going to feel better.
Yeah.
So their ability to make the decision, I need to speak to a lawyer, is really affected by the concussion. And quite often, the person with the concussion, weeks or months later, won't really know there's much different about how they function, but it's the mother, father, husband, wife, brother, sister, employer that'll say they're different.
Yeah.
So the person with the head injury has an impaired ability,
yes,
to make the right decisions, which is, I should go and see someone because I'm not functioning very well.
In British Columbia law, Bill, following an accident involving someone who was able to walk away but, you know, has been altered because of it, what is the timeline within which that person must do something legally if they're going to sue anybody for anything.
Yeah, the general limitation, and there are exceptions because there are things involving municipalities that have different limitation periods. But in British Columbia, if you're over the age of 19, the limitation period is 2 years from the date of the accident.
Okay, from the date of the accident.
If you are a minor, it's basically the limitation period begins at the age of 19 and it runs till the age of 21.
Oh, I see. Okay. And Joe, you've had many cases in your career where you've represented children who were injured at a very early age, and you literally have to wait until they reach the age. Is it 19 or
2 years from the time they turn 19? So it's the age of 21. Sterling,
and why do they do that? Would they postpone that?
Because if you're going to say to a person injured, it's too late because you didn't bring a claim, you have to wait till they're able on their own to bring the claim. So a child can't start a lawsuit. The court doesn't recognize that they've got that capacity,
of course,
until they turn 19. So the two-year rule fairly says it's 2 years from the time you were able as a person to start this lawsuit. And there are claims. I've had claims that arise out of injuries suffered by a child at birth.
Mm-hmm.
Those can be quite devastating.
A medical malpractice claim?
Yes. Right. And those often, the lawsuits started early because tragically, the extent of the injuries is fairly obvious. This poor child is disabled, that mm-hmm. they're never going to work. They're going to require constant care over their life. So you don't have to wait till the age of 20
sure.
to really determine that. But there are other cases of a child with a brain injury where you do, in my experience, have to wait till they're 18, 19, 20 so that you fully understand the long-term impact of their problems. And I had a young girl injured at the age of 7. Throughout school, she was on the honor roll, very hardworking, very bright kid. But we found when she finished high school, the best job she was able to do, the best job, was working as a cleaning lady, provided she went to the same houses and knew the routine.
Ah.
So
even though she graduated high school?
With honors.
Isn't that interesting?
But the reality is she was very bright. Brain injuries usually don't affect your intelligence.
Right.
They don't. I had a client following a devastating head injury where he needed brain surgery, where his residual IQ post-injury was 142. Geniuses are thought to start at 140. He was 142, but he was unemployable. And in fact, we found he wasn't able to do volunteer work because he just couldn't organize himself. So it's like
he had the IQ of a genius.
It's like a car with a huge, powerful engine, but the transmission doesn't work, so the car's not going anywhere.
Right.
Or the steering wheel isn't operable.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, you know, but these cases are all sort of unique and different, and each one of them has to be handled differently.
But for most people, with the obvious child exception in mind, for most of us involved in an accident in British Columbia, if you're going to take some action legally, it's got to be done within 2 years of the date of the accident.
That's right.
Yes. All right. Well, this is The Law Show on CIO 650. We're walking through the anatomy of an ICBC injury claim with Joe Murphy and Bill Dick from Murphy Batista here in Vancouver and Kelowna. And we're back with lots more right after this.
There's more of the show still ahead. This is The Law Show on CIO 650.